The Center for the Study of Religion and Conflict here at ASU recently invited John Burns as part of its public lecture series. Burns is the longest-serving foreign correspondent in the history of the New York Times. Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter was in Baghdad when American troops captured that city in 2003. Burns was just recently reassigned. Larry Lemmons spoke with Burns about reporting from the war zone.
When you think about this anniversary, there are 5 years, and you think about this milestone, 4,000 dead in Iraq. You were there from the very beginning when the bombs fell on Baghdad. Can you give me an idea, an overview, if you will, of the sort of experiences that you've had from the beginning of the invasion to the time that you had recently left?
Well, none of us could have imagined when American troops rolled into Baghdad in the first week of April of 2003, none of us could have imagined the disaster that would ensue. So to that extent, we've been pretty good at chronicling the failures of the Pentagon and the Bush administration in Iraq, but there was a failure of imagination on our part as well to foresee just how bad things would get. And I think that we need to think a little bit about that as journalists as to why it was those of us who were there when Saddam was still in power and stayed through the transition, in my case, on the run from the Mohabarat secret police during the period of the bombing until American troops, thank God, finally, from my point of view, finally arrived in Baghdad, that we had chronicled very fully the extent of Saddam's terror. I make no apology for that. Some on the left say that we paved the way to war because we made it possible for Bush administration officials, requoting what we were writing, to make the human rights case. What else could we have done? We were writing about the society in which we were then living. But what we didn't do, I think, was sufficiently explore the fissured history of Iraq, the depth of the trauma of the people of Iraq after 25 years of Saddam, and how unpromising that made the entire American project in Iraq from the beginning, that looked at now against that hinterland. I think you could say that the American project in Iraq was perhaps a mission impossible from the start.
Well, far be it from me to apologize for the New York Times, but honestly, I think most Americans were aware of Saddam Hussein's atrocities, at least from the time of the first invasion by George Bush's father. They knew that times were very difficult for the people of Iraq.
Well, as I say, I think not only is there no need to apologize for that, I think that it's something that now on the fifth anniversary, when we're, if you will, making a reckoning of the costs of this endeavor, it needs to be remembered also what was achieved. This wasn't just a tyranny like the others. Even a casual reading of the human rights reports of the last 10 or 15 years of Saddam's time, a knowledge of the terrible carnage of the Iran-Iraq war that he started, you know, establishes this man, in my mind, as one of the great criminals of modern times, one of the great criminals of all time. Of course, he was not a killer on the scale that, for example, Hitler was, or Stalin was,
yeah.
But then he didn't have the means that they had. He didn't have 50 panzer divisions. But within the means that were at his disposal, he was a killer on a very grand scale. In fact, the Iraq that I knew right up until April the 9th, 2003, was Murder Incorporated. And the ending of that was very definitely of benefit to the Iraqi people. I'm inclined to say to the entire Middle East, because he held in thrall much of the Middle East. But of course, the question now is at what cost?
Could you characterize the way that American troops have been received in Iraq, in terms of, has there been an animosity from many of the Muslims because they have been occupied by what has historically been a Christian nation?
That was something that you might hear in the mosques. It was certainly something you'd hear from Muqtada al-Sadr, from al-Qaeda, from the Islamic militant wing of the Saddamist insurgency. Most Iraqis were happy to be liberated, were not concerned. It was the most secular of all the major countries in the Middle East. It wasn't a deeply religious place. They weren't all festering with anger about the Crusades. They were subject to this terrible tyranny. They had attempted sporadically to liberate themselves, coup after coup after coup, with the coup conspirators all going to the gallows after extensive torture and mutilation. And they couldn't liberate themselves, and America liberated them. And I don't think that they were much concerned at that time about American soldiers with the Bible in their pocket.
Could you pinpoint a couple of moments in your experience in Iraq that you realized things were not going as people had hoped that they
could? Well, the first moment was on the very first day when the Marines entered Baghdad from the southeast, and there was large-scale looting, which was a sort of festival in its early manifestations. These hundreds of thousands of people poured out of what was then Saddam City, now Sadr City, in the northeast corner of Baghdad. And there were scenes of great merriment with teenagers taking office chairs out of ministries and loading the office chairs up to 15 or 20 feet with filing cabinets and pushing them home to Mama, God knows what she was going to make of the booty they were bringing home. And then, of course, it turned more serious, and they started looting the hospitals and museums. And late in the afternoon of that first day, I turned up with my friend John Lee Anderson of the New Yorker at the oil ministry. And there was no burning at the oil ministry, and the Marines were there protecting it. And the Marines told us that this was the only building they had orders to protect. And I must say, as one who believed that the liberation of Iraq by American forces was for the benefit of the Iraqi people, that was a bit jarring. That was the first time that we could see that something... And then pretty soon, by the end of that summer, the insurgency was manifest. They attacked the United Nations, the Red Cross, with major truck bombs. And we and the American commanders realized that the war had not ended. And the rest of those watersheds, I'm sure your viewers are very familiar with, Abu Ghraib, which a story that broke, as I recall, in the spring of 2004, so about a year later, was then and now scarcely believable to any of us. The flattening of Fallujah in November 2004, I mean, the city was very substantially destroyed in the liberation of it. I don't want to be in talking about these things. I want to make one point rather strongly, and that is that I and I think most of the reporters who have been embedded with U.S. forces in Iraq have emerged with a great respect and admiration for American troops, and these things were aberrations. The much greater truth about American military endeavors in Iraq are the myriad daily kindnesses that American troops are responsible for in their dealings with Iraqi people. They are not widely regarded as murderers and rapists. There have been incidents of that kind, and there are in every war. This is not to excuse it, but I had a brother-in-law who was, I think you could say, an authentic D-Day hero, who told me about many, many years later, before he died, about the things that happened when British troops crossed the Rhine in 1945, very few of which ever ended up in front of a court-martial. And it was very unpretty what happened. These things happen in wartime. They've certainly done enormous damage to the American endeavor in Iraq, but I don't think that they are the major story. I think that they are the lesser story if we want to judge... If America wants a judgment about the people it has sent to war, I think it can take some satisfaction from, in my view, is that American soldiers, American Marines, American airmen have behaved overwhelmingly in a way that this country has every reason to be proud of.
John Burns, thank you so much for talking to me.
Pleasure.